Good afternoon, church. It's not afternoon yet, is it? No, yeah, I'm already there I was already thinking it's noon because I'm already at the catechism lunch, or not the catechism, but the confirmation lunch. But we are in the second week of our pledge month. If you haven't yet filled out your pledge card, please do that. Put it in the offering plate as it comes by, or if you need more time to pray about it, you can get it to the church office in some other form or fashion. Today's kind of a busy day. I've mentioned that we do have the confirmation lunch for confirmands and their parents. We also, at 1:30 today, Paolo and his group will be at the Amistad, serenading the folks at Amistad. But it's not just the choir. Anyone that would like to be part of that, show up at 1:30 at Amistad. That's where you're meeting, right? 1:20. Okay. See, that's why he's the music guy and not me. I'm kind of, you know. So there we are. Bethany, you going to talk about bags for blessing? Is she here? No. So the youth last week did... serve and play. They put together bags of blessings, and they're intended for folks that need to be blessed. There's some toiletries in there, there's a Bible, there's some other things, there's some canned foods, and they're available for you to take from. We're asking people, don't take more than one per family. But if you know somebody, or if you'd like to be ready when you do see somebody that could use a blessing, they are outside in the narthex, the foyer, if you'd like to pick them up after church today. Don't go now. Okay. Any other? Yes. Diane, you want to talk about Bible studies?
Good morning. We have two women's Bible studies. One started Thursday night and one is starting tomorrow. I would encourage anyone for the Thursday night study, if you've ever asked this question, why me? Why is this happening to me? Why did this occur? Or why them? They don't deserve it. That might be a question some of us ask as well. And that's, I think, what Job is really about. And that certainly was our message Thursday night. I would encourage you to still join us, even though we have met for one session. Thursday nights at 6 and CLC 105. I really feel like it's going to be a great study, and it's good when you have those questions to be in fellowship with one another, mm-hmm. and can rely on one another to carry or share that burden. And then tomorrow we have the Jonah study starting at noon over in the CLC 105. And so if you would like to be a part of either of these studies, please do so. I think it can enrich your life.
Very good. Any other announcements? Then let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, your people are gathered. We're gathered with expectant hearts. We know you will honor your word. And your word says, where we gather in your name, there you become a member of the congregation, the most important member of the congregation, the reason for which we set aside all the things we worried about last week, things that we're going to do when we leave here. We're going to, for an hour, stop worrying about that and be in your presence and worship you. May it bring you glory. May it be pleasant to you. May you smile, Lord, as your people come before you and worship you. We ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
If you are able, please let's stand to sing hymn 98, To God Be the Glory.
Thank you.
Let's affirm our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Would the ushers please come forward? Let us pray. Lord, we give to please you. We give out of love. We love you, Lord, and we love your church, and we love the work of your hands. Let these gifts help accomplish the work of your hands. May they go from this house to bring mercy, to bring your love, to bring peace, to build things, to advance your kingdom. We ask this, Lord Jesus, in your mighty name. Amen.
Please be seated. Now it's young disciples' time.
Some things here in this bucket that have important jobs around our church. So, what is this? It's a spray. What is it? Do you know what it's used for? For cleaning, yes, protecting our wood here, not like all our pews in the sanctuary. What about this? Duster, yeah. Takes off the dust, right? That can ruin some of our nice things around the church. Okay. What's this? Paint. And what is this? A paint roller, right? You don't want the paint peeling on the church, right? It's not very nice for guests. What's this? A screw. What does a screw do? It staples it. Holds stuff together. Mm-hmm. Paisley. Put stuff together. Uh-huh. What is this tool for? Hammer. To bang things. A nail. Mm-hmm. It can also destroy, that's right. Yes. What can we do with this bucket? Yeah, to clean things, store things, right? So there's lots of tools we can use around our church building to make our building really nice. But Jesus taught us that the church isn't just our building. Guess who the church is? Well, this is Jesus' house, yes, but who is the church? He's the head of the church. I heard the right answer, Gina. God, or us, right? Us. We are the church. Okay, so I brought some tools so that we can talk about how we can be the church, right? The hammer might have fixed something, put it together, but what do these things do? What's this? It's a Bible, right? Do you think the church ought to know God's word? Can we use it to, like, find out how to pray for each other? Could we use God's word to encourage each other? Mm-hmm. I bet y'all like this one. Could you use this Bible to correct someone who's doing wrong? Oh, we love that one, don't we? Okay, what's this? A coloring book. Yeah, it's got scriptures in it. Who could you color a picture for?
For Jesus.
For Jesus. Who else?
God.
The Holy Spirit. And who else? Your mom. Mm-hmm. Each other. Yes, right? It's kind of comforting. What's this? It's a card, right? Do y'all ever send a card to anybody in the church? Yeah, why would we send a card? So we can what? Okay. What if somebody's sick or sad? Would it be nice, a feel better card? Mm-hmm. Okay, how about this one? It's a song thing, a hymnal, yes, a hymnal, right? What do people use this for, or the words on the screen? To sing to who? To God, right? Is it nice to hear each other sing? Yes, it's comforting, okay. What is, you might not know what this is. What do you think this is? It's kind of like a Bible study, right? It's a Sunday school lessons, yes. Do we teach each other here at church? Yes. Okay. What are these things you see sitting around when you come in the door? It's kind of like a prayer book. Yeah, it's a devotional, right? Can you give these away to people? Mm-hmm. I know Miss Paula does that. What are these things that are in the back of the pews? It's a card to pray for someone, yes. So these are just some of the tools we use for each other, because who is the church? Us, right? Us. This, what is this around us? A church building, right? But who is the church? Us. So we have tools to help our building. We have tools to help each other. And then guess who is a really good tool? Us. Yeah, we're tools as well. That could be, we could use that word in a couple of ways, but yes, we are instruments. How about that? Instruments. All right, let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, thank you for using us to be your instruments, to build up the church, which is us. Help us to love each other and see each other's needs. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the word. Psalm 26, verses 3 through 12. For I have always been mindful of your unfailing love and have lived in reliance on your faithfulness. I do not sit with the deceitful, nor do I associate with hypocrites. I have heard the assembly of evildoers and refuse to sit with the wicked. I wash my hands in innocence and go about your altar, Lord, proclaiming aloud your praise and telling of all your wonderful deeds. Lord, I love the house where you live, the place where your glory dwells. Do not take away my soul along with sinners, my life with those who are bloodthirsty, in whose hands are wicked schemes, whose right hands are full of bribes. I lead a blameless life. Deliver me and be merciful to me. My feet stand on level ground. In great congregation, I will praise the Lord. Hebrews 10, verses 22 through 25. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he has promised and faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. This is the word of God.
Home, sweet home. And I guess the kids have already answered the question, whose home is it? Well, it's God's. But the other answer that Bethany was trying to instill, you know, when she said that we are the church, So it's our home here too. We are the church. And of course, this building wouldn't be anything without God's people in it, right? If you went and took the same architecture, the same 2x4s and same wood, all the other things, and put it anywhere. But God's people didn't come and inhabit it, and by inhabiting it, fill it with God's presence, just be a building, right? Just an empty room. I don't know if you've ever been here in the middle of the week, come into this room, you know, sort of not know why you came to see Sandra or Sherry, and then think, maybe I'll go up into the sanctuary. Maybe it'll just be me there. But if you have, and I certainly have the privilege of coming in here by myself, and not just to check my rat traps. That's up in the attic, though, by the way. So don't look left and right to see if you're about to sit on one. But if you come in here, there is God's presence here. You feel it. And I know it's not just me. It's not my imagination. I have the privilege of a lot of people come to the church, and they come for other business. Especially, you know, after May 24th, we got a lot of people coming here to offer Uvalde this or that. And during the week, they learned that this was the entry point for a lot of helping the folks of Uvalde, and they came here. And I got to bring them to the sanctuary. And when they entered the sanctuary, they just felt, wow, this is a different place. This is a different space. And it wasn't just because of the people who laminated the floor, put the pews in here, did those improvements. It's because, of course, this church has a legacy, right? Been here a long time. People have been worshiping God here, crying out to God, giving God credit for things that maybe the world might think is a coincidence, but the people of God know it's no, this is his place. In this second week, as we look at our promise to support this local church, and I know that, you know, back when this church burned, when the little fire was, you know, made this sanctuary uninhabitable, Uvalde Methodist didn't quit being Uvalde Methodist, that people still gathered and found a place to worship, but they purposed to restore God's house and came back in and worshiped. So it isn't the building per se, but we do serve a promise-keeping God, a covenant-keeping God. And that's why in Psalm 26, we hear the words of a believer who was before us, you know, by the Holy Spirit saying, I love your house, O Lord. I love the place where you dwell and your presence dwells. God says, if we gather in his name, he comes. And this is true, not just here. I will even acknowledge that it may even happen across the street at the Baptist church. It happens where people gather and there is the residue of the holy left in that place. You say, Pastor, we're in church. You're, you know, the, like the old saying, you're preaching to the choir. And I am preaching to the choir, by the way. And I'm preaching to y'all. And you'll say, we're here. We don't need to hear this message. We are convinced. I might have let you off the hook if I hadn't lived through 2020. What happened in 2020? COVID. Do you know that since 2020, a lot of people who used to be in church every Sunday, kind of out of habit, kind of, that's what Texans do, that's what good people do, they don't go to church anymore. And so 2020 proved to me, you can't just assume people who go to church will always be in church. Now, COVID was bad, but it's amazing how the reasons that folks weren't meeting because of COVID, those things have gone bye-bye. They're not the case. Of course, if you really want to get Glenda wired up, and it doesn't take much to get her to preach, just mention all the things that were allowed to stay open and where people were able to congregate during COVID, and they didn't stop congregating, but somehow they were going to die if they went to church. Okay, enough of Glenda's sermon. I hear it a lot. But 2020 happened, and a lot of people quit gathering. A lot of people found other excuses to come or to not come. Of course, it's, you know, as I said, it doesn't have to be something bad to break the habit of going to church. It can be something good, like your kids, right? How many people have family members involved in sports and things like that that somehow can only meet on Sunday? They can only compete on Sunday. Now, you don't have to show a sign of hands. We're Methodists. We never raise our hands above our belt line anyhow, not in church. But there's many other things that compete with our presence on Sundays now. Good things, perfectly good things. And it doesn't take very many Sundays before you're out of the habit. And although we do, I mean, I like technology that even when I'm with the Navy and I can't be here, I can be in church. I'm not saying that technology is a bad alternative. I'm just saying there it's a substitute when you have no other means of being in God's presence. But as Bethany was teaching the kids, the church is us. And we're not single-celled organisms. We become the church as we gather as a body. And that's why God put in Hebrews 10, do not stop gathering together as some, after COVID, after sports, after whatever it was, after those who no longer gather as Uvalde Methodists. Because what happens when we don't gather? You know, actually, we look pretty good in our walk of faith. You know, when I don't have to stand side by side with, I'm thinking about the 9 o'clock service, and as Byron led the worship, all I could keep thinking about was, that boy is tall. You know, I'm not going to go stand next to him all day today. He makes me look short. And there's times where as we look about our walk with Jesus Christ, we're pretty good when we don't have to stand next to somebody who really walks the walk, who somehow can get through a situation without saying something salty. That's another reason people don't gather. It's easier to be a Christian. You know, you probably, I love the it's supposedly from a nun who, she said, Lord, I haven't taken your name in vain today. I have not been angry at my neighbor. And then she does a whole range of all the kind of quiet sins of omission that she hadn't done that day. But she says, Lord, in just a moment, I'm going to swing my feet over the edge of the bed. And, you know, all of these things are put at risk. And I think we're like her, or at least I am. I say, I do pretty good as a Christian as long as I don't get around other Christians. Yeah, that's a sermon in itself. But God purposed that when we get around each other, we are to spur one another. And I was told in the first service, now you're in Texas, spurring somebody, that's not a positive image. You know, that's spurring. There's a reason why the horse does something when you spur it. And it's because it's not pleasant to be spurred. And I said, well, you know, I think the Lord knew what he was talking about when he used that word in Hebrews. Now, they didn't speak Texas English back there in the Bible. But that word spurred actually is appropriate for pastoral people who would use a sharpened stick to get that goat to go where it needed to go. So it still was poking them. still was prodding them. And sometimes people don't go to church because they go, if I go, I'm going to be poked and prodded because they know I should be doing something than what I'm not doing. I'm kind of slothful. Or let's put it this way, I do what I like to do for God, and I don't do what I don't like to do for God. God requires a little sweat equity, or maybe even to go outside. I look at Glenda because Glenda doesn't like to go outside much. And the funny thing is, our dogs are even worse than she is. And we are those people. Our dogs are our children, our fur children. And there's times Glenda, she will say, okay, 10 more minutes outside, or 10 minutes I'll go outside. And then the dogs just stick their head through the doggy door and say, Mom, it's hot out there. We're going to stay here inside. And boop. The same kind of thing about our walk. We say, Lord, do I really have to go into that area where I'm not comfortable? And as long as you don't hang around with other Christians, you'll probably justify not going. And then Sunday rolls around, and it's time to gather, and you think, oh, I'm going to get to Sunday school, and so-and-so is going to ask me, did I do X? They are going to prod me to works of love and holiness, and I'm not going to like it. Maybe I won't go to church. Maybe I won't fulfill this promise that I made to support the church with presence, just coming. I mean, it's probably one of the easiest ways of serving God, and yet, yeah, I'm going to go there. The majority of Christians, and I think Uvalde's full, the majority would describe themselves as Christians. We know that we're not even going to have 10% of Uvalde in church today. Not even 10%. 1 in 10 in this Bible Belt town are not going to be in church today. And you want to say, why is that? When it's commanded, do not stop gathering together. Why won't you come home, sweet home, O church? You accepted me that I died in your place on the cross, that my son, his blood covered your sins, and yet you can't give me an hour once a week. I realize you guys don't need this. You might need a little bit of the message to say, when you feel someone's going to prod you, don't stay home on that Sunday. You need the prodding. But I think you need it all week long. Psalm 26 said, I stand on level ground. For me, it was powerful, all of the things that God put in there that this person said, you know, I don't hang around with this type of thug. I don't hang around with this kind of, you know, all of these sinners. And I thought, well, okay, as we're reading out that list, I hope there's those of us who say, I was once one of those. Or maybe I still struggle with those, and that's why I need the prodding. But here in God's house, even if the floor does slope down here, it slopes for a reason. The altar is level ground. I'm on level ground, and the presence of the great congregation is what the psalm ends with. And that's what I will end with today, to say, church, I know you probably don't need it, but when you see someone who used to come on Sunday, I hope you will prod them, encourage them, in some way say, get back in church. I realize out of doors, there's beautiful places where we can worship God in nature. But the bride, the church, it's in a building. When we come together, that is when it is home, sweet home, both for you and me and for God. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that you come among your people with the beauty and the expanse of the heavens. You don't need to come down here, but you do, because you love your people, you love your church. You want us You want to be among us, and you want us to be where you are. It is here in your church. Again, Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Please, let's stand if you are able to sing hymn 701, When We All Get to Heaven. Please be seated.
And hear now the benediction. Lord, thank you for your house, for your presence here. But we are about to leave this presence and go into the world that you knew we would live in, the times in which you knew we would live, because you want us to carry your glory from this house to change the atmosphere wherever we have lunch today, into our places of work during the week, into our families, into the relationships, all of those things, Lord, help us to carry from your house today to the transformation of our town, our families, our nation. We ask this in your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.